Hey there, my name is Sage and you're watching D&D Daily. Today I am doing a blind stat block reading of Beldros Witherbloom, the founding dragon of the College of Witherbloom. Let's get into it. The dragon Beldros masters the intertwined magic of life and death. Her power taps into the life force flowing through living things and the natural world. She manipulates that energy to give healing and life or to bring death and decay. Her mastery of this magic sustains her own life force even without the sustenance of food, drink, or even air. She founded Witherbloom College to pass on her understanding of the natural cycle. She hoped to create generations of stewards who would use her teachings to defend nature and help others. In keeping with the dichotomous nature of her philosophy and magic, she views the more dangerous aspects of nature, including the inevitability of death and decay, as natural and integral parts of existence. Taking a look at her artwork, you would think that that is a very evil dragon, but she's not. She is one you would say, do not judge the book by the cover. Something that particularly stands out to me that I like is the feathers. It's not like a stretched skin that is her wing like most dragons, but rather the feathers, and then her horns are tree branches, and she's got that acrid green mist in her chest. She's very cool. I like her. I definitely wouldn't want to run into her in a forest. That would be terrifying. But I do think it's pretty neat that they took her look and made it quite scary and intimidating, despite being a good dragon. Beldros Witherbloom. She is a gargantuan dragon, but also a druid. She is neutral good, has an armor class of 22 and 444 hit points, a speed of 40 feet and a flying speed of 80 feet, and a swimming speed of 40 feet. Plus 9 to strength, plus 2 to dexterity, plus 8 to constitution, plus 4 to intelligence, plus 9 to wisdom, and plus 3 to charisma. These are the stats that I've come to expect after reading so many Fizban stat blocks. These very high, powerful stats that come with dragons. And she stands toe-to-toe with those over on Fizban's side of things. She has proficiency in dexterity, constitution, wisdom, and charisma saving throws, arcana, medicine, nature, and perception skills. She is immune to necrotic and poison, and immune to the poison condition. She has a blindsight out to 120 feet and a passive perception of 26. She speaks common, draconic, druidic, and sylvan. She has a challenge rating 24 with a proficiency bonus of plus 7. She has 3 legendary resistances a day, and she does not require air, food, or drink. She has a multi-attack, and she can make 1 bite attack and 2 claw attacks. Her bite attack is a melee weapon attack, plus 16 to hit with a reach of 15 feet on one target. On a hit, it does 1d10 plus 9 damage, piercing damage to be specific, plus 6. The bite attack is a melee weapon attack with a plus 16 to hit and a reach out to 15 feet. It hits one target, and on a hit, it does 1d10 plus 9 piercing damage, plus an additional 1d12 necrotic damage. Her claw is a melee weapon attack with plus 16 to hit, a reach out to 10 feet. It hits one target, and on a hit, it does 1d6 plus 9 slashing damage, and if the target is a huge or smaller creature, it is knocked prone. So we want to open up with a claw attack and follow it up with the bite and claw attack afterwards. Her breath weapon attack is a decaying breath. It recharges on a 5 or a 6. Beldros excels decaying energy in a 90-foot cone. Each creature in that area must make a DC 23 constitution saving throw, taking 6d12 necrotic damage and 6d12 poison damage on a failed save, or half as much damage on a successful one. A creature that takes damage from this breath can't regain hit points until the start of Beldros' next turn. That's quite good to limit the healing. So that's something, that's one of the only reasons I've seen a dragon not want to open up with a breath weapon attack, but rather to hold it until they're at around mid-health. And then when you hit them with the breath weapon attack, now they can't heal a whole turn and they have to deal with her, her legendary actions, and potentially that breath weapon again, and her claw attacks, all while not being able to heal is pretty devastating. Unlike most dragons, Beldros comes with another action. It's called Miasmal Flow. Beldros becomes a swirling cloud of green mist and can move up to half her flying speed without provoking opportunity attacks, then reassumes her true form. During this movement, she can move through creatures and objects as if they were difficult terrain. If she moves through a creature, it must succeed on a DC 23 constitution saving throw or become poisoned until the end of its next turn. If Beldros ends this move inside an object, she takes 1d10 force damage and is shunted to the nearest unoccupied space. So a couple things I have to say about that. There's actually quite a bit to unpack with that one, because it's a pseudo-teleport. It's also a damaging spell. But something that stands out to me is she is gargantuan. And how exactly is she going to pass through somebody, if every piece of movement is considered difficult terrain because there's one, you know, 5 foot square of a person who's blocking her movement, and it's gonna be very difficult for her not to appear where there's a tree, you know, and she's gonna have to take that damage and be shunted. I like it, but you have to be very specific with how you move, because you could end up moving, it already says half your flying speed, which is 40 feet, but if you're going through somebody, that's gonna become 20 feet super fast. So something just to keep in mind. And Beldros comes with spell casting. She can cast each of these once per day. She has greater restoration, mass cure wounds, plant growth, revivify, and speak with dead. That is a spell list that is not gonna come into combat pretty much at all. I cannot see her using any of those in combat. All of those are out of combat spells. Finally, Beldros has her legendary actions. The first one is Claw. She just simply makes a claw attack. The second one is Miasmal Flow, which allows her to use her Miasmal Flow from before. This one costs 2 legendary actions. And finally, we have Teeming with Life, which costs all 3 of her legendary actions. Beldros magically summons 1d4 pest mascots. In unoccupied spaces, she can see within 60 feet of herself. The pests obey her commands and take their turn immediately after hers. Any creature other than a pest takes 2d8 poison damage if it starts its turn within 5 feet of one or more of these pests. When one of these pests drops to 0 hit points, Beldros regains 9 hit points. These pests disappear after 10 minutes, when Beldros dies or when she uses this action again. This one is interesting because you are summoning, and you're summoning 1 through 4 creatures. These creatures are a challenge rating of 1/4. They have an armor class of 13, a hit points of 22, and a speed of 30 feet. So she basically spreads these pests out. You want at least one of them within 5 feet of every one of the attackers of Beldros. And so each turn they're going to be taking 2d8 poison damage. Then if they want to attack them, they're going to have to use some of their action economy to get rid of them. And it also heals her. Interesting. But there is all the chance in the world that you're using 3 legendary actions and you end up rolling a 1. So this is something... There's no reason for her not to start combat with it, right? She can cast it every 6 seconds, and then they last for 10 minutes. And so it's very likely that she would start combat with 4. Because she just... There's no cost to it. She can just keep them there as she sees fit. I probably would not use Teeming with Life in combat, though. Its cost is simply too high. Those 3 legendary actions can be 3 claw attacks, or it can be a Miasmal Flow, which allows her to get a free disengage. That potentially poisons some or all of her enemies. And so by using Teeming with Life, you're really lowering your damage output or your defensive mobility. So the final verdict on Teeming with Life is start the combat with her with 4 of these things and just have them be part of the combat, but then don't summon more, most likely. Another interesting thing you could do with Teeming with Life is hit and run tactics, which she is definitely intelligent enough to do. She could fly in. Let's see, it's a 60 feet. So she can fly in 60 feet above the enemies, summon these, and fly away. As they fight, they heal her, they do extra damage to the enemies, and by the time that they're done killing them, she can just fly down again, summon them again, and fly away. It'd be a very frustrating tactic to deal with, and definitely something she could do, especially with a breath weapon attack to go along with it. That might be her tactic, honestly. Fly away, fly in, breath weapon attack, drop Teeming with Life, fly out, get healed, do it, rinse, repeat. Oh, that would be frustrating to fight, but it's a tool she has. Alright, so the final verdict on Beldros Witherbloom. She is a super powerful dragon. Up there with the other legendary dragons. Higher than most, actually. She has excellent hit-and-run tactics, self-healing. She has breath weapon attack that can reduce their healing. Her spells aren't exactly meant for combat, but that's okay. She has plenty of other things to be used for combat. A pretty straightforward stat block at the end of the day. If you're looking for a dragon with a little bit of a twist, here you go. Simple as that. You're not getting too far away from the other dragons. It's a pretty in line with them. And so I'm not saying this is like changing up the game. You know, it's pretty straightforward dragon stat block with a couple extra tools in the toolkit. The most annoying of which is the Teeming with Life hit and run tactic, I think. All right, this has been my blind stat block reading of Beldros Witherbloom. Hope you enjoyed it, and I hope to see you on the next one. We are D&D Daily, and we release new content every day, so it might be worth hitting that subscribe button. See you on the next one.